Mistakes and errors with minimal access surgery. In this presentation, we are going to summarize some of the important points. And if you will keep in memory, then the chances of mistakes in the laparoscopy will be less. Concept and mind setup of any mistake. Human is made for committing mistake. It is virtually impossible that you will not do the mistake in your life. Mistake is an integral part of the human psychology. And any error or mistake, if it happens, it has two outcomes. Either there will be few consequences or it will be without consequences. If the consequences are there, then 90% it will be near misses. If there is no consequences, it is called as near misses. And if the consequences are there, it will result either in complication or catastrophes. Just like suppose you are driving a car and for a fraction of second you were sleeping. Suddenly you awake, 90% of the time you will see that no consequences were there and you were correct, there was no any accident. That is called as near misses, that means saved by the God. And 10% of the time it will result in some consequences. Those consequences may be only complication, like you will hit the ramp of the road and you will break your wheel cover, or you will hit another car in front and you will break your glasses. But among all those consequences, 10% is catastrophe. In that there may be someone will be injured seriously, or maybe someone die. So altogether 1% of all the mistake which we do, it has catastrophe. Arthur L. Bloomfield, he has told, there are some patients whom we cannot help, but there are none whom we cannot harm. Especially it is very true in minimal access surgery, because it is a virtual surgery which we do on the image. For that, HRA is applicable in all high-risk industry. HRA stands for Human Reliability Analysis. In all the developed country now, for all the high-risk industry, HRA has to be implemented. In the United Kingdom, there is UKMHRA that is taking care of all the reliability of the surgeons and in healthcare. Aviation industry, one human error can lead to the death of hundreds of people. In nuclear industry, one human error can lead to the death of millions of people. In satellite industry, if human error is there, then there is a loss of millions of dollars. Not only that, if any satellite, if it is not up to the mark of the standard parameter, and if it is going to the universe and from without leaving the gravity of the earth, it started coming back, then you can imagine what will happen. Once upon a time, if you remember, one Skylab was there, which was launched and it could not reach, it started coming back. It was panicked all over the world that where it will fall. But it was near misses, so ultimately it went to sea. So it was saved by the God. Cloning industry, one human error can be disaster for entire humanity. Because by genetic engineering it is possible to make a human clone. And it is possible that someone will make a clone in such a way that it will be 100 times more IQ than the human, or maybe 100 times more physical strength. We never know, on any island maybe some of the mad scientists making some human clone, and it will be a separate race that will be like a monster or maybe superhuman, and then they will use us as a pig to learn laparoscopy. Because they will feel that we are inferior. So cloning industry also comes under HRA. But why this innocent surgery, minimal access surgery they put under HRA? The reason is data capture facility is available. HRA you can only implement where data is available. In aviation industry there is a black box inside the aeroplane. And if any accident happens, they try to find out that black box. And in that black box there is one hard disk with together with the, some recording devices. And they can find it out that who was the main terrorist, or it was a bomb blast, or what was there. Nuclear, satellite and cloning industry is always under 24-hour CCTV surveillance. And in minimal access surgery, you have to, by court of law, you have to record your videos. So whenever any medical legal happens, they will ask the video of the surgery, and then they can find out our mistake. In open surgery, it is very difficult to find out the mistake of surgeon, because during procedure, you yourself are hiding the target of dissection. Even if you will use head mirror or you will use camera, complete recording of the open surgery is not possible. If you put in the YouTube, abdominal hysterectomy, there is no video. Not possible, because your hand is talking, your fingers are talking with the tissue. So, a lot of effort is required to record the each and every clamping of the stump in the abdominal hysterectomy. It is not possible. But in laparoscopy, it is very much possible, because it is surgery on the image and you are seeing on the monitor, and one data capture device will be connected. So that's why HRA is applicable in minimal access surgery. If you will see, every day in India itself 200 cases of the medico-legal cases are there. And most of those cases, the problem is with the doctors. Court tells doctor to pay for the living cause, where man moves court against doc. Many a time they say doctor dissected the novel profession. Court direct police to file case against the clinic doctors. Health department right to home on IMA demand. NRI doctor spent 1 crore in prolonged quest of justice. Women sterilized without consent. So there is a danger to the profession. And now, man moves court against doc. So, you have to serve also, and you have to protect yourself also. It is a very interesting profession, where you have to play with the life, but if something goes wrong, your own life is in trouble. For that, Rasmussen has given the level of the human error. The human error which happens, it has three levels. One is a skill-based level, another is rule-based level, and third is knowledge-based level. A skill-based level means learning curve. Learning curve is S-shaped. Initially, whenever, whatever you learn, initially it looks like frustrating. You feel like that, okay, you are learning new skill, will you be able to master this? Even if you play a keyboard, or if you drive, or if you sing, then initially it looks like that it is not going to happen. But once you will break the inertia, then there is a very steep rise in learning curve. Within your first 50 to 100 cases, your learning improves dramatically. Each and every new case will be better than the previous, because you will get your skill improvement. Once you will perform 200 cases, then you will get a plateau. Suppose you have performed 200 cholecystectomy, then 201 is not going to give you some extra information. And people say that if it is 400, then it deteriorates. Just like the S, tip of the S. Why it deteriorates? Because of the overconfidence and sometime age factor. That's why it is said that if you want to make a community of minimal access surgeon, which is highly skilled, then catch them young. If they will start their skill improvement in the younger age, then they can develop their skill much better compared to the elderly group. Just like if you want to get a gold medal in the Olympic, you should catch an 8-year, 9-year old boy. You can train every day, maybe he will get a gold medal for you. But if I will catch a 60-year old boy, then there is no possibility of gold medal. Maybe he will be not qualified also. So a skill-based level learning curve is important. But for the surgeons, they are young up to 45 years. Up to 45 years also you have started, then it is correct time. After 60 or 70 years, learning laparoscopy is difficult, it has been proved. Because of the cognitive learning skill, anyway decreases after 60, 70 years. So they have to work more hard to learn at that age. This is a skill-based level, nobody can help here. And learning curve, everyone has to cross his own. You have taken birth alone. Unfortunately, when you will die, you will be alone. Nobody will go with you. And this learning curve, nobody can catch your arm and pull it up. More yourself, you will expose yourself to the laparoscopy. More yourself involved in the skill, your learning curve will be fast. Rule-based level. This is the second level of the human error. First, if your learning curve is not good, skill is not improved, then you will do mistake. Second is rule-based level. That misapplication of good rule and application of bad rules. Rules, our senior has given the rule, rule for access, rule for pneumoperitoneum, rule for dissection technique, rules for energy sources. But sometime we don't follow the rule. And we make our own rule. Or we misapply the good rule. My professor, Professor Sir Alfred Kasheri, who is known as father of laparoscopy in Europe, still if you will see his surgery, he put it, variceal irrigation test, suction test, hanging drop test. Sometimes we used to say that, Prof, we are in, connect the gas. He said, no, the day you will stop using the good rules, bad are waiting to enter in your habit. So even if you are sure, but then also rules should be followed. Then accident will be less. Just like a traffic rule. The driver who follow the rule of traffic, they have less accident. So this rule we should never try to avoid. It should be used properly. And knowledge-based level. This is the third level of human error. That incorrect knowledge or incomplete knowledge. Unfortunately, amount of knowledge which is increasing now is becoming double in 4 years only. In 80s, at the time of our fathers, the knowledge was taking 20-year time to get doubled. But now due to Google and information technology, within 4 years, amount of knowledge is doubling. And that's why the government has implemented CME, continued medical education. And incorrect or incomplete knowledge is dangerous. Technology is developing so fast that our knowledge should be up to date, and sometime we have to unlearn and again relearn. So if these three levels of human error, if you will correct ourselves, then chances are there that mistake will be minimum. Then comes categories of human error. There are two categories of human error. First is related to the performance of frontline operator. And second is latent, hidden within the system. And accident is waiting to happen. Who is frontline operator? You are frontline operator. And whenever something goes wrong, as a responsible captain of the team, you will immediately put some defense measure. Suppose you are doing hysterectomy, uterine artery is bleeding and you could not control. Immediately you will open the abdomen. Or if you have perforated some bowel, you will ask the surgeon to come and repair it. Because effect is immediate. If any error happens due to the frontline operator mistake. But unfortunately, in laparoscopy, most of the mistake which happens is latent, hidden within the system. That is a system failure. You are a very good surgeon, but your hook was broken, uninsulated. Your insufflator setting is not good. Your electrical setting of the bipolar, monopolar is not good. And many of the technical aspects is team related. Team, entire team should be knowing the thing what you do, and system has to be corrected. If you go to the member area, in your member area, in the first page, first one given, that is checklist. I don't know you have seen or not. That checklist you should print in A4 size paper, and you should put hundreds of checklists in your OT. And whenever you come, you ask your nurse that all the checklists should be checked. And that will decrease your 32% of the mistakes can be minimized. That checklist is given by the Aaron and the Sajid. So, if you will correct your system, the error can be minimized. Now, human reliability embarrasses three disciplines: ergonomics, psychology, and engineering. Ergonomics means already we know it is interface between man and machine. Generally, we are only interested seeing the front of the trolley, but you should see must the back of the trolley, all the cables which is attached. Sometimes we think that this is a job of your staff, your nurse, but it is not. This is your job to know each and every connection, each and every engineering components. What are the cable, what is S-video, what is composite, what is RGB, what is HDMI, what is DVI, and how to connect it. Some of the ergonomic points just I will revise. OT table height is very important, and it should be in such a way that the handle of the instrument should be at the level of the elbow of the surgeon. Then 60 degree manipulation angle should be achieved. Then baseball diamond concept should be followed, which say that the half of the instrument in, half of the instrument out, telescope in the center and manipulation angle 60 degree. Then elevation angle ideal 15 to 30 degree. Then you should prevent losing the instrument. If instrument is lost, then don't try to find out by mistake. What do you do? First you take telescope out and then bring the instrument out and go with the same elevation angle and 30 degree azimuth angle your tip of the telescope is there. Blindly we should not try to find it out. Then coaxial alignment has to be maintained. Eye of the surgeon, target of dissection and center of the monitor should be in the same line. Then the resting eye should see 10 to 20 degree down, because our oculomotor muscle is normally resting at that position and there will be no eyeball degradation. Your performance will be better. Distance of the monitor should be 5 times to the diagonal length of the monitor screen. This distance is important. If you are using 14-inch monitor, you should stand 70-inch away. And if it is 21-inch, you should stand 105-inch away from the monitor. Then, number of monitor ideally should be 2. One for you, one for your assistant. If you have only one, then you should keep in such a way that there should not be more than 15-degree head tilt. Because as soon as more than 15 degree head tilt is there, cleidomastoid muscle get stretched and your performance will deteriorate immediately. OT light should be 20 lux. More than 20 lux will decrease the resolution of the light, just like on this screen if you will switch on the light in the room. we cannot see better. Then avoid touching the bloody viscera with the telescope, especially sometime when bleeding happens. At that time, camera person should not be over enthusiastic to go very near to the bleeding spot. Otherwise, sometime a spurt of the blood can immediately make the tip of the telescope completely soiled with the red color. You should prevent fogging. To prevent fogging, there are many techniques. The best is to use the warmer, either warm saline or to keep the telescope, some warmer pack is available. It is just like a heat pad which we are using for knee joint pain or something. There is a box in which there is a heater. And generally, formalin tablet and telescope will be dropped into that so that whenever you take it out, it will be completely warm. Warm telescope will not create fogging. Fogging is generally due to the temperature of the telescope. If it is less than the abdominal cavity temperature, then fogging happens. So warming is the best technique. Second is you can use some anti-fogging solution. But they are not as effective as warming. And it is expensive. 5 ml costs you 700-800 rupees. You can use betadine also. Sometimes it has paraffin, which will make a film over the telescope. And then if the fog dew drops get deposited, it will be dropped down. It will slip. It will slip from the telescope due to surface tension increases. And then fogging can be minimized. Sometimes you can use to touch the clean peritoneum of the solid organ like uterus or liver, and that also can clean the fog and it can be prevented. But take care that it should be only for fogging, because if fogging is happening, that means your telescope is cold. And with the cold telescope, if you will touch some organ, it will not burn. But don't use this habit to clean your telescope. Sometimes the telescope tip is blood stained. Then instead of cleaning over the organ, you should take it out and clean with the gauze piece. So we should be able to differentiate between dirty telescope and fogging telescope. Keep telescope steady. One of the big mistakes is that camera person is holding the telescope very casual. They should keep the arm by the side and then they should hold the camera. That's why when you are doing the pelvic surgery, left hand should be used, because arm will be by the side. And in the upper abdominal surgery, right hand should be used. In upper abdominal surgery, camera person will be left to the surgeon. And in lower abdominal surgery, camera person will be right to the surgeon. And there should not be jerky movement, because if it is casually, it is jerking, then there is eyeball degradation. And due to eyeball degradation, judgment and dexterity of the surgeon will be affected. Judgment of the surgeon and dexterity of the surgeon will be compromised. Keep panoramic vision when surgeon is inactive. Sometimes surgeon is tying a knot outside or trying to change the instrument, trying to get the needle holder seizures. At that time, camera person should keep panoramic view so that he can see the tip of all the instrument together. Because if surgeon is inactive, he is not seeing on the monitor and he is busy tying a knot, and camera person has also left the telescope and he is seeing surgeon only, by the time you will go with the knot, organ is not there. It is already avulged. Or instrument has pierced the diaphragm. Or some bowel loop is hooked. So always keep panoramic vision when surgeon is inactive. That you have to train your camera person. That this is your responsibility to take care that any instrument is not leaving the held part and it is not piercing some other organ. Because surgeon has to be concentrated on the target of the dissection and he is not seeing the fundus who is passing through the diaphragm, or he is not seeing the infundilopelvic ligament which is pulled by any other assistant. Mirrored image is blunder. That's why you could not get this $100. Because if action axis and vision axis is opposite to each other, then there will be paradoxical movement. If you move right, your instrument move left. And then there will be a problem. So we should take care that in any time, port position should not be that, it should be mirror image. Sectorization can be avoided, but sometimes sectorization is possible, that is called as ipsilateral port position. And main advantage is that allow the surgeon to move freely as the camera is away from the operative field and there is no physical contact between the surgeon and camera holder. But even if you are doing sectorization, distance between two instruments should be not more than 7.5 centimeter. Otherwise, if this angle is less than 30 degree, you cannot work. In ipsilateral port position, your manipulation angle is 30 degree. In contralateral port position, your manipulation angle is 60 degree. Wrong port position is responsible for most of the complication. Here, this is a simple appendectomy. There was one iliocolic artery coming in the way. One port in the umbilicus, one is coming from right iliac fossa. This is wrong instrument, which is opposite to the telescope. And you can see that here, this video I have shown you also first day. This is iliocecal junction here. And this is a band there. And surgeon is trying to catch this with the ligature. And now he is giving over traction. Remember, any time if you give traction, it is not possible to seal the vessel. Here, three ergonomical mistakes are there. One is swording. Another is this telescope is opposite to the telescope, this instrument. And third is a lot of traction. And now he is trying to cook, and it could not be cooked. Now the problem is he cannot bring the other instrument due to mirror image. This instrument is not able to bring it nearer. And bleeding is happening, but he is helpless because of the wrong ergonomics. So most of the time, this type of accident happens due to the wrong port position. If the distance between two instruments is less than 5 centimeters, it is absolutely bad because it will create swording at the level of cannula itself. And now there is no any way except removing and putting another. Sometime you have to avoid gesture imprecision. What is gesture imprecision? That 5 mm instrument, generally in the 12 mm or 10 mm cannula should be avoided. And if you have to use it, use long reducers. Gesture imprecision means there is a lack of hold on the top or at the tip of the cannula. So sometimes it will move like that. And if it is free, sometime when it is touching here, it will behave like a type 2 lever. When it will touch here, it will behave like type 3 lever. And then your gesture imprecision will be wrong, and your surgery will start becoming little difficult. Suddenly you will not realize, but suddenly your skill level will deteriorate, your task performance will be affected. Shadow should be properly used. And shadow gives you the advantage of depth perception. Like here you can see that this is a shadow of the hook and this is hook. Now this shadow is giving the idea that how much is the distance. Otherwise, if the shadow would not have been there, then you cannot say that this hook is touching the gallbladder or not. But because shadow has a distance, that means it is away. And as soon as the hook will touch the gallbladder, the shadow will also touch the gallbladder. Shadow is very important. And actually, I have done few works in the shadow. And my thesis was also in the optimum shadow casting illumination for endoscopic task performance. That was published in 2004. It was ready. And now I have 5-6 articles regarding the shadow telescope. And Astrology is using this technology now in their telescope, which was sold by our university to them. So engineering part is also important. Minimal access surgery is a medical byproduct of engineering. It is something imposed by engineers over the doctors. So you should try to involve yourself in the different engineering component. See the monitor, see the insufflator, see the camera. You should know about the different connections. Just like your mobile phone, applications are there and you should know what are the applications. Then only you can get 100% efficiency of your any gadget. And this is our profession, so you should must learn. Lack of engineering knowledge is very bad. Poorly engineered equipment also should be avoided. Lack of periodical checkup should not be there. We should make a routine that after every 1 month or 15 minutes, every instrument will be checked and insufflator will be calibrated. Electrosurgery should be calibrated. All the instrument, all the cylinder will be checked and tested. Okay, you could put one a sticker. Faulty power supply is one of the big problem, especially in country like India. So you should put one UPS, online UPS, in your all the cameras, because it will blow, because sometimes voltage is fluctuating very high. So one 3.5 kVA in UPS, online UPS will be sufficient for your entire trolley, including monopolar, bipolar, harmonic, camera, TV, 3.5, and that will give you a backup also for 1 hour. So if within half of the surgery, if the power supply is gone, then at least you can continue your surgery. So power supply should be very good, and it should be sine wave, it should be very flat, otherwise instrument get destroyed very easily. Now, psychology of minimal access surgery, that minimal access surgery is often prejudiced. Sometimes we are impatient, over-enthusiastic, reluctant to training and dependent to other. Impatient means, if surgery is difficult, you should be more slow. Patience is the key in minimal access surgery. We should not be over-enthusiastic. Whenever you think that surgery is not under your control, then we should try to convert. Reluctant to training, there is an answer of every problem. And if you are doing same mistake, suppose you are doing uterine artery coagulation and every time it bleeds, that means we are missing some of the step. And we should must ask to our colleague or to seniors or to your association, and then try to put a defense system so it should not happen. Any mistake, if it happens 3 times, that means our technique is wrong. And for that, we have to get a training. Even after going from here, in your member area, we have one file sharing. So if you will do any surgery and suppose you have any doubt, you can upload your portion of video and we will definitely help you. Or you have any question, we are getting a lot of email every day, and we have a medical legal forum also. There is one Apex insurance company in India that is doing the indemnity insurance for the doctors. And we are in the advisory board of that insurance company, so legal advice also you can get from us. Like if something goes wrong with your patient, you should not hesitate, you should send an email that this problem happens, how to save ourselves. And a lot of expert lawyers are there who know the trick how to save yourself.
To whom I send the video?
You can send to us through your member area, you can upload. And definitely we will be your side, we will not go to your patient's side. And this is because we are colleague and we have this responsibility to help. Not only that, sometime association also can help you. And in those cases, sometime if the authenticity of training is also sometime required, we are getting letters very often from the different embassy of the world, asking about the certificate recognition and its credential. And in those situations, we have all the data, and we send that he is fully qualified, and he has taken training, and he has the fellowship or diploma. So that way, we should try to protect ourselves also, which is important. Now depends to others. In laparoscopy, we should not be dependent to other people. Other means, some surgeons have a bad habit that they are dependent on their assistant, their OT assistant, and actually assistant is doing surgery. They always assist their assistant in open surgery. You might have seen, in every small district level hospital, there are 2-3 assistants, and that assistant is making all the other surgeons to work. They are freelancers, they go from one place to another, they will have the call. They are very polite, they will never let you know also that, otherwise you will not call them. Very humble, very intelligent. And they will assist you. In front of that assistant, you feel yourself confident, because he is there, both will do the case. In laparoscopy, this is not going to work. Your left hand is your assistant, your right hand is your surgeon. And if you are dependent to, if you are making yourself dependent to your assistant, you are spoiling yourself. So everything, all the responsibility you have to take. And then your progress will be real progress. So dependent to other is not possible in minimal access surgery. There are two types of risk factors for iatrogenic injury. First is patient risk factor, second is surgeon risk factor. Patient risk factor, some patient has previous surgery, adhesion, obesity and difficult anatomy, abnormal anatomy, rare anatomy. In those situations you cannot help. Those patients, they are risky. But there are many mistakes or risk factors which is in the surgeon. Some do not have necessary attribute for laparoscopy. This line was written by Reason. Reason is one error identifying surgeon who has given that some people do not have the necessary attribute to become a laparoscopic surgeon. Means they are not technically fit to do laparoscopy. And those people, they have the electronic phobia. They cannot become a very good in computer. Even if in their house, if they have to switch on the TV, they call their son, can you put the news there? Or can you switch on the DVD for me? Those persons are not fit for any technical profession. Sometimes you might have seen that some people get recruited for the Air Force, and after 6 months, Air Force is sending them back, giving a letter that not fit for Air Force job, technically not fit. Reason is, for that person, entire force or entire aircraft should not be in danger. Because they may be fit for other job, managerial job, or the simple physician job, but becoming a laparoscopic surgeon, some do not have necessary attribute. And how they have find it out? That they try to find it out different type of personality. And according to trait of personality, the learning curve is going fast. The people who are very good in software, very computer loving people, gadget loving people, good in photography, good in camera, good in mobile, those were good in laparoscopy. Because those persons, they don't have electronic phobia. And in laparoscopy, you are surrounded by so many cables. And if you are upset and any instrument, suppose light is not coming, you will become completely upset. And you cannot correct yourself, you cannot change your bulb yourself. But fortunately, in this batch, there is no one like that. Sometime we get that type of a student also. And we understand, but we carry out anyhow. But here, this batch is fantastic, so it is okay. Second is misuse of energized instrument. Just like I have given the example that if you have a hammer in your hand, everything looks like a nail. So once you have energy, we want to use more and more energy. And more energy you will use, more chances of complications and iatrogenic injury will be there. So misuse of energized instrument is another bad habit within the surgeon. Third, inexperienced faulty technique or learning curve. That is slowly you will develop. And the first and most important is misinterpretation of anatomy. Most important factor why the surgeon do complication in laparoscopic surgery, that what they are seeing actually it is not there. Their anatomy they are seeing is wrong. And why it happens? Because of optical illusion. Surgeon operate on image rather than reality, and visual psychological study has shown that success and disaster depend upon a snapshot interpretation. Our brain works with the snapshot. Once you enter into the abdomen, as I told you, if you are working in the pelvis, first you take snapshots of all the nine structures. Median, medial, lateral, Cooper, inguinal, snapshots, and remember in the brain. Exactly same way, if you are doing cholecystectomy, take the snapshots and keep it as a memory. Because once the dissection is started and everything becomes blood stained and anatomy is disrupted, at that time your snapshot only helps. And a good surgeon, they have the better snapshot. A bad surgeon, they collect the wrong data. And what will be your snapshot, it will not be mine. It will not be your friend. Just like if you remember your medical college from where you have graduated, for everyone, different picture will pop up in your brain. Nucleus 42 is responsible for that. We have one memory spots which checks the snapshot in the brain. If you will remember about medical college, for someone the main building of medical college will come. For another board of medical college will come. For your friend the surgery department will come. For another maybe the principal will come or the main professor. And for the other people, maybe the boyfriend and girlfriend which has maximally influenced them during their medical college, it will pop up. Whenever they will think about medical college, that will come in your mind. And what is coming, that only you know. Other people, they are not seeing the same thing. Exactly same way, if this is a gallbladder, you know, suppose you want to perform the cholecystectomy, then absolute anatomy should be memorized, like these vessels, these peritoneal fold, or Rovier circle, or the critical view of angles. But you should not remember the liver or the hepatic duct or the CBD or the duodenum. You know absolute anatomy. Just like suppose you are going in front of this hospital and some criminal person was there and you started fighting with him. And then after that you decided I will go to police and I will complain against him. You go to the police. Police will ask first question, who was that person? You will say, I don't know who was that person, but at the place where he was fighting with me, there one horse was also there. Black horse was there. Police will say, still the horse is there? No, horse was moving, it may be somewhere else. But that at that time it was there. This is useless. They cannot help you. They will say, it is not appropriate information for me to catch anyone. Then you will say, okay, if you cannot find out the horse, then there was one hospital also there. Then it is of little information, police will come, inquire in the hospital who was the person. But that also is not possible. But if you will give absolute anatomy, the person was 5.8 feet height, with the mustache, with the black hair, with the jacket. There was one logo also here, isn't it? And that university logo, so then they can find it. Or his car number was this, his bike number was this. He was telling that he is a son of a great person, his father is MLA, like that, then it is a correct information. You can find it out. Exactly same way, once you do laparoscopy, always try to memorize the absolute anatomy. Just like in this picture, tell me what you are seeing. Okay, a dog is there, isn't it?
Yes.
Anybody else?
Tree.
Tree is there, very good. Anybody else? Crocodile is also there. Another? Do you know where is the dog? This is dog. This is the mouth of a dog. This is forelimb. This is hind limb. Tree is also there. And this is shadow of the tree. Crocodile is also there. You know, this is upper jaw. And this is a lower jaw of crocodile. You know, there is a face of a lady also here. Isn't it? And there is a bull also. Don't see this dog. You see a small that much only. Here is the head. This is neck. This is, and there is a bull fighter. Who is trying to fight? But the people who are convinced with the dog, they will always see dog. They will say, no, no, you are wrong. This is dog only. Exactly same way, once you see the anatomy and your first snapshot before starting surgery, memorize the absolute anatomy up to the point of absolute certainty. Don't touch the uterus or gallbladder or ovary without absolutely taking the snapshot and memorizing. You behave it like your enemy which you have to crush. Just like if you are fighting with someone, and during fighting itself you have made your plan that once he will go, I will go to the police directly, then your attitude seeing him will be different. You will start gathering the data because you have to go next, your next point is police station. So you will try to gather the information and taking the snapshots. Exactly same way, as soon as you enter, otherwise there is optical illusions. These are optical illusions which happens day to day, every day laparoscopy. You know, these all lines are looking curved, but none of the lines are curved, all are parallel. Horizontal as well as longitudinal, all the lines are parallel. But why it is looking? Because it is optical illusion. If you see in the center of this image and put your head little in and out, you will see it is rotating. If it is not rotating, it will rotate now. See in this image. Can you see that? It is rotating. The circle is coming from this eye and entering into another eye. This is not a video. I am not pressing any play button. This is a picture. But it is called as optical illusion because of the relative contrast of the picture. Sometime without bleeding you will start seeing glare. And sometime glare will be missed like a bleeding. Sometime ureter start looking like uterine artery. Uterine artery looks like ureter. Because curved pathway become a straight line become curved. Because it is two-dimensional image and these are optical illusions. If you see, these circles are looking straight, but all is curved circle. This is curved circle. What you are seeing in this image? Angel. Anything else? There is a bat also. This is a image which is used by psychologists to decide which force is governing you. If you are seeing bat, first this is bat. This is the ear of the bat, this is wing of the bat. If you are seeing bat first, that means evil force is governing you. And if you are seeing angel first, here is the angel. The face, the wing, the skirt, the foot, she is praying. So then good force is governing you. Exactly same way, bad, but if you will see very carefully, as soon as you will concentrate on the angel, bad will disappear. And if you will concentrate on the bad, angel will disappear. So if you will see the angel, you will cut uterine. If you will see the bad, you will cut the ureter. Because optical illusions are there which will interweave each other. So most common bad habits. What are the most common bad habit? One bad habit is confident entry and exit. Without seeing the pathway of entry and exit of the instrument, we should blindly not push it in. You might have seen during your animal dissection that sometime the bowel get trapped into the cannula, especially if the cannula is leaking. And suppose you are going with the scissors or the hook, you will pierce it, you will go there, you will perform surgery and you will come out also. And patient will come with the peritonitis after 2 days, not at that time. So it is a very bad habit. Another bad habit is overshooting. Overshooting means tip of the instrument going beyond the field of vision. This is a bad habit. Ignorance of assistant port. As a surgeon, this is your responsibility to see that all the assistants, they are doing their job properly and they are holding their structure properly. If you will not do that, it is a bad habit. Less irrigation and suction, bad habit. Irrigation and suction should be done at a time of bleeding, but sometime without bleeding also. Suppose there is a tube ovarian mass. Go irrigation, suction, and keep on irrigating and sucking there. People are thinking that you are cleaning, but actually you are buying time to decide that how to progress in the surgery. And suction irrigation is just like you might have seen suction irrigation I was doing during that perforated appendix. I was not cleaning actually. I was thinking what to do. Isn't it? Thinking what to do, where is the appendix? And with the tip of the instrument, it is a blunt instrument probe which can give you the idea. And you can negotiate with the pathology that let me do the surgery. And it gives you few advantages. One advantage, humidity of the abdominal cavity will maintain. Other advantage, once the saline will go there, then bipolar works better. Saline is required for bipolar both the jaw. That's why many gynecologists, before attempting the bipolar, they irrigate the normal saline. And third advantage, what will happen? That it will give you better interpretation of anatomy. So less irrigation and suction is a bad habit. Then ignorance of final inspection is a bad habit. Once you have finished the surgery, at least 1 clockwise direction all around, you must see the telescope before coming out. Just like when you are leaving your house, you are checking that tapes are closed or not, AC is switched off or not, gas is switched off or not. So before coming out of the abdomen, final inspection should be done. If you are ignoring it, it is a bad habit. Because sometimes you will see port side bleeding is there, sometimes inferior epigastric was bleeding, sometimes accidentally you will find out some perforation. If you can recognize it immediately, you can correct it, you can suture it. High pressure of pneumoperitoneum is a bad habit. Whenever we have difficulty in vision, we try to increase our pressure. That can lead to many complications, already you know. Decrease in venous return, decrease in cardiac output, microatelectasis of the lung, hypercarbia, air embolism, all will be increased. And less blunt dissection. We should try to do blunt dissection. Only two organs you should not do blunt dissection. One is bowel, another is tube. Because scar tissue is always stronger than the bowel serosa. So if bowel is directly incarcerated to the abdominal wall, then seizure should be used, micro dissection. So these are some bad habits which we should never allow to come in our practice. Now conversion psychology, there are two types of conversion. One is elective conversion, another is enforced conversion. Elective conversion means initial assessment of the anatomy and trial dissection. Trial dissection only for 20 minutes. Within 20 minutes, if you see the surgery is not progressing, surgery is not proceeding, and lack of progress is time to convert. It is always asked that whom to convert, whom not to convert. This is a simple answer, lack of progress is time to convert. At any moment of time, if you think that now you are helpless, you don't know how to go, you have lost all the way, you should convert. But even if it is a very bad gallbladder, bad uterus, bad myoma, and surgery is progressing, maybe very slow, but if it is progressing, you should never convert, otherwise you will not learn. So at least try to do laparoscopically, and at the point where it is stuck now, not proceeding, then convert. Colorectal surgeons, they do the same way. They mobilize the entire rectum and all, and then they convert it to do the anastomosis or put the anvil. What is the advantage? Because at least a half of the surgery, if you can do by laparoscopy, this is an achievement. Next time it will progress further. But lack of progress is time to convert. This is conversion psychology, that is called as elective conversion. And in elective conversion, only minimal increase in morbidity will be there. Another type of conversion is enforced conversion. Enforced conversion means you have decided, no, I will do by laparoscopy only, because you have given a lot of commitment to your assistant, a patient, and surgeon has to convert. That is, patient is forcing you to convert because something wrong happened. Bowel get perforated, artery started bleeding, bladder get ruptured. And now conversion is called enforced conversion. And enforced conversion has a lot of complication, morbidity as well as mortality. Mortality also can happen. Surgeon has to convert, and then major complication will be there. So always try to go for elective conversion. Never put yourself in a situation of enforced conversion. Then fatigue psychology. Laparoscopy is cerebrally 3 times more intensive than the open surgery. So suppose you have 2-3 surgery in same day, they don't do laparoscopy last. Do it first. Sometimes we think, let us finish all the open surgery, then I will do laparoscopy. And once you are little fatigued cerebrally or physically, your performance will deteriorate. Because it is cerebrally 3 times more intensive. So laparoscopy should be in the fresh mind, with the fresh energy. Then degradation of eyeball fixation. This should be avoided. How to do that? Tell the camera person to keep steady. It should not be jerky. Otherwise image moves and your snapshot will be also bad, and your judgment and dexterity will be affected. Golden period. Golden period for laparoscopic surgery is 45 minutes to 90 minutes. After that, you should give 5 to 10 minutes strategic rest break. When I was in Imperial College, London, my professor was George Hanna, Egyptian. He was with me in Nine Wells also. And then he became the head of the department and professor of the molecular oncology and the surgery in the Imperial College, London, a smoker, very chain smoker. And during half of the surgery, he is going to smoke. Then nurse complained that during surgery also he is smoking. Professor called and asked that, you have to give the written explanation. You have a lot of complaint is there against you. Now, unfortunately, internet is not connected, otherwise I would have shown you. Now, he put 2-3 articles and showed the director and the head of the department. And that is written strategic rest break during laparoscopy. If you put strategic rest break laparoscopy in Google, you have many articles published. And it is said that after every 45 to 90 minutes maximum, you should leave your patient for 5 minutes to 10 minutes without CO2. Means, remove the instrument and deflate the abdomen. Do you know why? All the insult which is done by the CO2 will be compensated. Due to that CO2 for 90 minutes inside the abdomen, all the change in the hemodynamic, small air bubble started forming, venous return decrease, minute volume, tidal volume, everything becomes wrong. But if you leave your patient 5 minutes, all the accumulated CO2 will be washed out. Microarterial lung will fully expand. Deep vein thrombosis, which was started due to the decrease in venous return, will be corrected. Renal perfusion increases. Pulmonary edema decreases, and then your patient is again ready to tolerate 90 minutes abuse of carbon dioxide. And I'm not saying to go and smoke, but after every 90 minutes, you should leave the patient and then sit somewhere for 5 minutes. It is for you, but it is more than you, it is for your patient. If it is a big surgery, radical hysterectomy or gastrectomy or the bypass, strategic rest break is necessary. And it is very much helpful to your patient recovery. I am not saying if you are doing cholecystectomy and if you have already dissected the gallbladder, it was just about to come out and ting, the time and stop. Don't do that. You should wait 5 minutes more and take it out. But suppose you are doing bilateral hernia. If one-sided hernia only has taken 1 hour time, then you should give a strategic rest break before starting other side. Or if you are doing bilateral big salpingophrectomy or ovarian cyst or endometrioma or radical hysterectomy, lymphadenectomy, right side of iliac lymph node you have removed, completely cleaned. Now already 90 minutes is over, then a strategic rest break is must. In the meantime, once the CO2 is not there, you can ask your assistant to change the trolley and this little bit so that other side ergonomically it will be perfect. Operating DO. Initially, whenever you start, at least someone who know laparoscopy should be with you. For that, you may have to train some assistant, or maybe you can call someone who has already assisted some of their senior surgeons. Just like sometime in the local Delhi NCR, some new surgeon, they sometimes request that, sir, can you send the motin? And you can always think that if he will go, he will be helpful, isn't it? In giving the instrument, in showing the camera, in assisting. So exactly same way, whenever you have to break your inertia, operating in DO is better. Either two surgeons or maybe one good assistant. That will be very helpful to start the surgery, and they can share their execution of the procedure together. But never perform in the presence of someone who may be a cause of embarrassment for you. Sometimes you will call a big surgeon and he is, you will feel like giving exam in front of you, in front of him, and you will be anxious. So it should be humble, and from inside he should be willing to help you. Then your fatigue psychology will not be dominant and performance will be better. Self-assessment is important. Always define component steps of surgery, inter-step and intra-step. Means when you are sleeping, dream about the steps of the surgery. Each and every inter-step procedural is easy to remember, but intra-step is also equally important. That each and every moment where you will hold the fallopian tube, how you will separate the bladder, and just like a movie in your brain, it should continue like a reel. And once you will see the entire movie during surgery, you have to replicate it. You know, our brain always see forward what we do. And if your execution of the task is nicely framed in your brain, your performance will be better. For that, it is important that you should see unedited videos. Edited videos has sometimes some steps are cut, and generally those cut steps surgeon they leave. All the edited videos is cut video, edited video, where the bleeding was, it is cut. Broad ligament entire was not shown in the half, it is cut. And speed is also double. So we give the wrong impression in our brain. And then we translate the wrong steps. So this should be your own analysis and define the component steps of the surgery. Improve your ergonomics as much as possible. Analyze a video for a surgery was successful or it was converted, it doesn't matter. Take a pen and paper and analyze your own video. Overshooting 2 times, less dissection 3 times, more energy 2 times, ignorance of entry and exit 2 times. Give marks to yourself by seeing your videos which you have recorded. And next time the mistake which you have done will not happen. And then every time we can improve. You know, in laparoscopic surgery, seeing your own video is very helpful. Because we can find out our own mistake. In open surgery, it is not possible. In open surgery, abdomen is closed, chapter is closed. But in laparoscopy, your learning starts with your videos. Give marks to yourself after each operation. That out of 10, how much you got. Never give 9 or 10 out of 10 to you. Means every time we should try to improve that. Next time I will improve this. Next time I will improve that. Maintain your instrument yourself, especially some of the instruments like needle holder should be yours. Because sometime in 2008, the president of the Society of American Gastrointestinal Endosurgeon, Stephen D. Wexner, who has written the 4 book of my textbook, he came to perform some colorectal surgery. And in World Congress at that time. And before he come, 2 of his resident, they bring all his instrument. We say that we have already harmonic and everything. And all the instruments we have in India, why you are bringing it to USA? He said, no, I don't perform surgery by others' instrument. I use my instrument. Do you know why? Because every instrument, every make has different feel. Like the grasper of the starch and grasper of the ethicon is different. Even the serration makes a difference. And if you are habituated with one type of instrument, you should continue that only. If you will ask any musician to give his instrument, he will not give you. A guitarist, if you will offer that this is a $1 million guitar, take it and give yours to me, he will not give you. Maybe later he can give, but at the time of concert he will not give you. Because he is habituated with his instrument. The batsmen, they don't often change their bats. They use same brand or they keep their bat with them. So we should also maintain our instrument ourselves, have a break after every 45 minutes and keep low threshold of conversion. So if we will do this self-assessment, then many of our mistakes and errors can be minimized. Practice makes the man perfect. So we should try to practice as much as possible on the endo trainers. Either you can buy some commercially available or you can make your own and then practice it. That is the big advantage of laparoscopy, and your introcia, your lumbricals, your depth perception, your tissue handling capacity, it improves. You will be surprised how it is improving, but it improves. Error cannot be zero. It should be in LARP region. Reduce the error to LARP. LARP means as low as reasonably possible. Human cannot live without error. Human errors are inevitable. You cannot avoid it. It has to be there. But if it is LARP region, it is good. And then we should predict what may go wrong and then insert a defense system so next time this mistake will not happen. So, human error, it is a tip of iceberg, but sometime it becomes disaster and which we must control in the LARP region. And those who were sleeping can open their eyes now. It has 2 meaning. One meaning is already you know, second meaning is if we are not seeing the laparoscopy with these eyes, then we should think a laparoscopy is a skill, and to improve it, you should work differently. And then your performance will be definitely improved.